south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, let's get started by talking about how to make 20-plus bucks an hour teaching Chinese kids online. Why am I bringing this up? Again? Well, because I'd say at least half the people coming down to Latin America and living their plan B or part-time plan B will need or want to have a job sooner or later. Let's face it, unless you're retired or an old codger, or as the Brits say, a geezer. By the way, that was the name of the bass player in Black Sabbath, Geezer. Anyway, if you come down before you're retired, your nest egg, whatever it is, will eventually run out unless you're independently wealthy. And I'd say probably about 20% of the people who come down with a plan B fall into that category. In other words, they really don't ever have to work again. But you'll find if you come down here and you don't eventually find something to do, a hobby or hobbies, whatever, you could end up totally bored and fate could end up choosing your new hobby, whether you like it or not. The most common one for idle hands and minds down here is booze, specifically beer, because, you know, we are talking about the tropics, right? So anyway, those cards, letters, and emails are always coming in asking me about teaching Chinese kids online, because that and call center work and English teaching in schools here in Latin America, and of course bartending or being a hotel receptionist if you're on or near the tourist trail, are the quickest and easiest routes to making some money in a hurry. And there's an especially great demand for real live gringo and gringa English teachers, because you see down here in Latin America, there are many, many upscale helicopter schools and private language academies. They're all over the place, too. By the way, it's always been a pattern of mine. When I run into a Latino that speaks pretty good English, I always say, "Where'd you learn your English?" And man, it's surprising. I've never once had a person say they learned it at a private English academy. Those places just seem to be for show. Glorified coffee clutch and hangouts for upscale, mostly Latinas and bored, wealthy housewives and their entitled kids. Hey, I'm not saying you can't learn your English at one of those academies, but I've never met a Latino or a Latina who has. So then what about sitting at home on your sofa in your underwear, eating Cheetos and teaching Chinese kids for 20-something bucks an hour? Now, because I get so much email on this, I have to tell you about some new changes going on that Mr. B, our resident expert in teaching English to Chinese kids online, just set me wise to. And to that effect, Mr. B has put together a very up-to-date PDF document explaining the whole English teaching online thing, how to apply, how to get started, the works. In it, he answers all the questions people usually ask me, and I'm not the expert. So I'd like to once and for all set you straight on exactly what it's all about and what you have to do. And in the end, we'll talk about some English teacher recruitment ads I just came across. I'm talking about upscale helicopter schools that are looking for gringos and gringas, and those private English teaching academies. Now, if you get one of those jobs, you'll soon find out. You'll be teaching mostly entitled rich kids and their parents. And if you wonder how I can make a blanket statement like that, I know some of you are thinking, "Johnny, you're such an ass, you're so cruel." Well, their upscale gringo wannabe parents are the only ones that can afford those schools. And if you think it's not like father, like son, like daughter, like mother, you'd be wrong. I've seen it in action 1,000 times. If you're a Latino or Latina and your parents are extreme gringo wannabes whose big motivation in life is to shop in my jammy and go to Disney World and post all that crap on Facebook, well, how do you think their kids are going to turn out? When speaking of wealthy gringo wannabes and their Facebook posts, the ones that really make me laugh and used to drive me nuts, I did get over it, are the ones showing that Latino family somewhere up in the States standing or playing in the snow. I tell you, there is this Latino obsession to take photos in the snow and paste them all over Facebook. It's that old one-upmanship game. You know what I'm talking about. I get around more than you, and I'm more gringo-wise than you are. How could it be otherwise? They've got the same things on their wish list. Number one, to visit and go shopping in my jammy. Number two, to visit Disney World. Three, to take photos in the snow and post them on Facebook to make their friends and relatives at home envious. Though I suppose it's the same thing for gringos who've never traveled. And when you do, and first land in a tropical port, you take a bunch of pictures. But if you have a half a brain and decent self-esteem, after you've posted a few, it's over. But it seems with most Latinos, it's never over. The ones with dough that get to the States are forever posting pictures on social media, milking the hell out of it, just to show off and make their friends and family back home envious. Doesn't that sound familiar? I mean, really, what else is social media about? Posting great destinations, parties, restaurants, and activities, showing your friends, family, and acquaintances what a great life you're having. Think about it. With posting all that stuff, they're implying that their great and happy life is better than yours. So anyway, that's just one of my pet peeves, especially when Latinos post photos of themselves playing in the snow. All right. One or two pictures in the snow? Well, that's all right, I guess. But when they start showing up everywhere, Facebook, Instacrap, Pinterest, Tinder, screensavers, photos on dating apps, please spare me. I don't want to see any more of your playing in the snow photos. Thank you very much. Am I being too petty here? Too harsh? Well, we all have our pet peeves. Oh, and I've had a few conversations with upscale Latins who sent me those playing in the snow photos. And I almost always take that opportunity to pop their bubble. I say, you know what? I'm from Chicago. If you took a random poll of 100 people on the street and asked them how much they liked cold and snow, 90% would say, are you nuts? It really sucks. And the other 10% would say they like it. They're lying or only like it when it happens on Christmas Eve, you know, to set the mood and all that. The truth is, if you live in the snow belt, a nice fresh snowstorm is all right for about 10 minutes. But the next day, or even in a few hours after the cars have made a total sloppy, dirty mess out of it, that's when it wears on you. You gotta shovel it, you track it into your house and car, and when it melts, it gets slushy, you get soakers. Then, often overnight, it gets cold and refreezes. Everything's slick as hell, you gotta chip it off your windshield, there's more car accidents. Hey, I don't have to explain any of this to you guys up in Jersey or Cleveland. But trying to explain that to a Latino, forget about it. And as far as Christmas Eve, well, a nice little dusting of snow is cool. But we're talking about maybe 10 or 12 hours out of the whole year. You know, I don't get it. Why Latinos think posting a photo frolicking in the snow is the be-all to end-all. Even crazier, with upscale Latinos, it's a talking point at parties. In fact, I've actually seen what seems like family snow photo competitions. Imagine people getting together at a party, sharing and comparing snow photos on their cell phones. But I know how to rain on that party. You should see the looks I get when they're doing the snow photo thing when I tell them, I hate snow. If you want to see some crazy looks and twisted smiles, try that sometime. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, I've been in many upscale Latino homes where they've got framed photos of themselves playing in the snow in strategic locations around the house. Come on, did you ever know anyone up in the States by you who's ever done that? Maybe a few shots in a scrapbook where the kids are playing in the snow, tobogganing, skating, whatever. But never a nicely framed snow shot grouping for bragging rights. Though I have to admit, a lot of gringos and expats up in the States have beach and vacation shots stuck all over their refrigerators. But at least there's nothing permanent about that. I know. A lot of you are thinking right now, Johnny, what are you ranting on such a stupid topic for? Well, it's because there comes a time, you know, when you've just had it with Latinos telling you the same old thing, that their greatest wish in life, aside from winning the lottery, is to shop in Miami, go to Disney World, and post a million shots on social media playing in the snow. Yeah, I know. I must have said it 100 times. For upscale and wealthy Latinos, it's all about the show and bragging through social media how great their lives are. But really, it's not all that much different compared to what's going down with social media up in the States, is it? Except for the fact that up in the States, people are deathly afraid of hurting some snowflake or snowflake group's feelings on social media. Boo-hoo. All right, back to Mr. B's brand new, nicely documented PDF explaining exactly what you have to do to get in on the teaching Chinese kids English on the internet. All right, I'll go through these points quickly. Number one, you must prove you are from an English-speaking country. Number two, some companies have an age limit. In some cases, if you're above 60, you don't qualify. But it's very flexible and depends on your interview. Yes, you will have an interview online. So don't think the age restrictions are solidly enforced. They're not. Number three, you have to have a decent desktop or laptop PC. They frown on phone and tablets for this kind of work. Some companies make you sign contracts, others don't. And the ones that do, offer them for 6 and 12 months. Though the contracts are not really binding, you or the company can terminate with notice. Number four, you have to do your teaching in a spot that's very quiet, No noise, no air conditioner noise, no barking dogs or chicken buses. Though Mr. B says sometimes he'll hear some dogs barking or there'll be some noise in the background, and nothing happened. So with him, there's been noise, but no complaints. Number five, you'll be working on Beijing time. So if you're in Central America, like Mr. B is, it's a 14-hour difference. In other words, 6 p.m. in Beijing is 4 a.m. in Guatemala, or Panama, Costa Rica, Belize, anywhere in Central America. Number six, you'll have to have at least 10 megabytes per second download internet speed. Easy enough to do. Most internet providers offer double that and more. By the way, he says some companies will actually require you to do a speed test that they can see. Number seven, I think it's number seven. Remember, you'll be teaching kids. Are you comfortable teaching kids between the ages of 4 and 16? That means, Mr. B says, you must have patience. Well, I guess that counts me out. I don't have patience for kids. Never did, and I've never denied it. Hey, I'm not the only one. Remember W.C. Fields? He used to say he liked kids with ketchup. Oh, and then Mr. B says, if you have a phone or a tablet, you really can't teach kids, but you can teach adults. But teaching adults is not a stable enough income, he says. Number eight. Most companies pay monthly on the 15th. Sometimes, though, you get paid on the 10th. And once he said he got paid on the 24th. That's 9 days late. Hey, he's telling it like it is. Number nine. Some companies require you to work at least 4 to 12 contracted hours a week. This is just the minimum. You can always request more, and they'll give them to you. Now, here's the thing a lot of people get stuck on. Mr. B says you must have a TESOL or TEFL with an ICOES number. That's a certain kind of English teaching certificate. But the good news is, Mr. B says he knows a great place you can get it. Very cheap and fast. Now, you have to remember, Mr. B himself is a high school graduate. He's got a GED, so you don't have to have a college degree. That's something people are always asking me, and the answer is always the same, no. Though a lot of people investigating these things on the net insist you need to have a college degree, that's not true. You've got it from the horse's mouth here. Mr. B's the expert. Number 10, in the area you're doing your teaching, you need to have a childish or childlike background attraction. In other words, happy, colorful, smiley things in the background. Now, of course, that doesn't mean kids like that stuff, but adults seem to think kids do, so it's kind of required. Mr. B says you can set this up on some kind of background board after the interview. But it looks better if you have it done before the interview. He says in his case, he taped two poster boards together, taped them to the wall, and then printed out a map and some cartoon characters. He says he knows the companies he works with like the idea that he put a map up there. Good idea, Mr. B. Like I said, it might not mean anything to the kids, but as long as parents in the company you work for think it does, you know how life is. It's mostly about appearances. Remember that old cliche, half of being a success is just showing up on time? That seems to be true. All right, then Mr. B says all of the points that were previously mentioned have to be addressed before you fill out your application. Next, number 12, you have to have a good Logitech or Microsoft headset, preferably the USB plug-in type. The headset must be purchased before your interview. That's what you're going to use. You'll need it for your interview and for them to see that you have a decent headset. It doesn't have to be the best, but don't go too cheap either. If they can't hear you because you purchased a really cheap job, this will affect the outcome of your interview. Try to be a detailed gringo type. I paid $65 for mine, he says, and I only could find it at Office Depot a few years back when I first started this, and had to buy it in Guatemala. But now they're all over the place online and much cheaper at Amazon. Then, Mr. B says, if you don't think this kind of teaching is for you, teaching Chinese kids online, he says he knows of some other online work options for you. Mr. B will answer your questions too. On this PDF he gave me, he's got a list of services. It says here, I'll answer all of your questions for $30, and we can talk online till we get it sorted out. He says if you work with him, this will include an accredited, easy and cheap way to get your TESOL TFL certificate, with all the proper links to the recommended companies, too. He said the Skype or online consult will be around 20 minutes, and he'll give you all the pointers necessary for your interview. And as mentioned, he says he has some other online work options if teaching English is not for you. All right, so right up front, I have to mention that $30 consult with Mr. B, it's his thing 100%. I don't make a dime off it. So then why am I doing this, informing you guys right now? Well, there's two reasons. For one, I'm not the expert. If but I get lots of inquiries. Number two, I know and like Mr. B. He's an honest guy, upbeat, happy, really a great guy, who came down here to Latin America and had to find his niche, and he found it. So there's no BS or no fluff to what he's got to say. So if you're interested, and I know a lot of you are, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com, and I'll shoot you this PDF that's got all his contact information on it, too. And, you know, besides the fact I get a steady trickle of inquiries about teaching English, there's something else you really have to know. If you're looking to get a job teaching at one of these private English academies, there's a lot of them. Like, for example, one called Harmony, one's called Oxford. Then there's European Academy, that's Academia Europero. There are many of them, private academies, where they'll contract gringos and expats, even locals who speak pretty good English, to teach hourly. Well, I'm here to tell you right now, if you hire on with one of those outfits, you won't like it. You'll get pissed off in a hurry. I know people who've done it. They get used and abused. If someone doesn't show up for the lesson, you don't get paid, and worse. In fact, let me read you this classified ad from a well-known English language news website coming out of Ecuador. They're looking to hire 100% gringo and gringa English teachers. I'll go ahead and read part of it to you. Now, the fact is, if you didn't know anyone who's ever worked at a place like this, you'd probably think it wasn't a bad deal. Here's what it said. There's an English academy in Ecuador called CEDEI. They're seeking teachers for the April 2020 cycle. They say here, we have three locations in Cuenca offering English classes to more than 1,000 students with a staff of at least 50 teachers. We currently have a high need for English-speaking teachers for our Saturday classes, which are 3 to 4 hours long. We have children's classes, teen and adult classes, too. It says applicants should be able to commit to teaching a minimum of 1 10-week cycle, starting date Saturday, April 18, 2020. And here's what they require from you. It says teachers are expected to participate in an approximately 3-day unpaid orientation to be done before the cycle starts, with minimum requirements, an associate degree or bachelor's degree. Number two, some teaching experience. Number three, must be a native English speaker or have fluent English. Then it says, we strongly prefer you have a TEFL, CELTA, or TESOL certificate. Then it says, to get that certificate, there's a minimum of 100 hours in the program, including classes. That means you'll be paying for that yourself and putting in that time. Then it says, interested candidates, please submit your resume to the contact listed at this posting. Then it says, the pay is, get this, $7 an hour. Does that sound good to you? Would you bite? Now, if I happen to have read you this classified ad before you ever knew about Mr. B and the fact that he makes more than 20 bucks an hour from home, well, if you needed a job, you just might go for that English teaching academy job. Then there's that little matter of the 100 plus hours and those teaching certificates you'll have to get. Now, if you remember, Mr. B said he knows of a very fast, cheap, and easy way to get those certificates. So then what's it going to be? Making 20 plus bucks an hour from your home, or work for one of those English academies, like this place in Ecuador, CEDEI, where you have to show up at their offices to teach the kids, and you only get $7 an hour. What they're not telling you is if the kid or kids don't show up, you don't get paid. Whereas Mr. B has often said, when you're teaching Chinese kids online, you can pick up extra hours really quickly by checking a daily list of opportunities to fill in for people who are sick or have a last-minute problem or schedule change and just can't do it. So then what's it going to be? $7 an hour or $20-plus dollars an hour? A no-brainer, right? And do remember, I know some people who work at these academies, and every one of them complains about it. Whereas Mr. B, he's a happy camper. He likes his job. Why? Well, I think it's because if you do it Mr. B's way, you're not really working for the man. You're sort of your own boss, setting your own hours. All right, enough said about that. Oh, and feel free to send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com, if you want me to send you a copy of this Ecuador English Academy classified ad. Then you can see for yourself what it takes to make $7 an hour. Question is, would you really work for $7 an hour? A lot of gringos and expats do, especially backpacker types who don't have a real definitive plan. They travel around, find places they like, and they stay sometimes weeks, months, even years. And you know, most of them are backpackers for a reason. They don't have a lot of dough. So to stay for a longer while in a country they really like, they have to pick up little jobs here and there. And that's why you see so many of them bartending, waiting on tables, and working the front desk at mom and pop hotels, but mostly on the gringo tourist trail. When you're way off the gringo tourist trail, like I am probably 98% of the time, You almost never see gringos and expats working those kind of jobs. But they do work teaching English in helicopter schools and in English academies. Oh, and you heard me mention that if you get a job teaching at a helicopter school, you'll get a regular semester or yearly contract. And you also heard me say that one of my friends has been Teacher of the Year in one of the top Guatemalan helicopter schools for many years now. So he's at the very top of the pay scale, naturally. So then what's he making? 14 grand a year. He told me at his school, starting pay for an English teaching gringo, we're talking full-time teacher now, it's around 8 grand a year. And that's your salary for the first couple of years. Question is, what's that work out to an hour? Well, you know, for teachers, it's not just about classroom time. It's also how much time you spend at home prepping for your classes, grading papers, and all that unpaid extra time you spend when kids have events and field trips, etc. However, it's easy to calculate an hourly rate if you just want to find out how much a teacher is getting paid by the hour just for the time spent at school. All right, let's do the numbers. Based on what my teacher friend tells me, he shows up at 8 and leaves around 4 or 5. He spends around 40 hours a week at school. And you know, all schools have something like a 3-month vacation period spread out all over the calendar. Figure 12 weeks. So multiply 40 hours a week times 40 weeks, you get 1,600 hours. Divide that into the $8,000 a year starting salary. That'll remain the same for a couple of years. And it turns out, just counting the time at school, a teacher makes around $5 an hour. You got that? $5 an hour, teaching at a high-end private helicopter school. So that's what you're in for if you decide to take one of those jobs. Hey, nothing wrong with that. Some people like teaching kids. I hear that from teachers down here, but I certainly don't hear it from people up in the States anymore. That's a whole different universe of metal detectors and political correctness, safe spaces, snowflakes, Ritalin, psychotropic drugs, and plenty of four-letter words emanating from the kids in class and in the halls, as well, I'm sure, as the teacher's lounge. All right, let's take a few emails. Here's one from good old Captain Mango. Here he's referring to a show I did a week or so ago, talking about rebar sticking through the roofs of so many occupied buildings. Yep, a really ugly sight that's kind of the textbook definition for third world, because you don't see it up in the first world. It's just not permitted. Anyway, he says, Johnny, the late Anthony Bourdain, the famous chef who offed himself, possibly a Clinton body count member, once referred on his show to roof rebar as, quote, the ubiquitous symbol of third world optimism. I like that. He had a way with words. Well, thanks for that, Captain Mango. By the way, what is the unofficial Clinton body count up to now? Last I heard, it was 60-something. Seems to me whoever wrote that book should be updating it every 6 months or so, don't you think? And now, an email from longtime listener Edison. He says, Dear Johnny, I like it a lot when you talk about mating and dating in Latin America. There are lots of mating and dating sites and blogs referring to gringos hooking up with Latinas and Latinos mating and dating gringas. But for my money, no one tells it like it is, nor the way you particularly phrase it, like you. Just for reference, Johnny, I'm an older guy on the wrong side of 40, you could say, who gets obsessively devoting an ungodly amount of time to whatever I'm interested in or searching for on the net at the moment. And at the moment, it's dating. Little background here, Johnny. I'm what you might call one of those anal techie gringos, formerly known as pencil-necked geeks. That was what they called us in the 80s and 90s. I was called that name many times early in the game. What I'm saying, Johnny, is that when us pencil-necked geeks get obsessed, we get anal about it. So here's my 2 cents in my research about dating in the 2020s, coming from a 40-something two-time divorcee with a plan B. So I'm back in the dating game again, this time homing in on Latinas as the objects of my affections, south of the border. Actually, south of the border, as you recommend. About a year and a half ago, after my second divorce, I looked at myself in the mirror and said, man, you got to get in shape if you ever plan on getting back in the game. Funny enough, Johnny, whilst at the gym, I noticed some guys actually use corsets. Talk about a humiliating experience. Can you imagine going on a date with a girl? Talk about a passion killer. With the final reveal being a corset? No gracias. So I did it, Johnny. I got into shape, and I don't even have to Photoshop myself when going on the dating sites. Though it is kind of disturbing now that everyone does it. Used to be the dating sites after my first divorce were the real thing because it wasn't sophisticated and you could see what people look like. Nowadays, you could have an ongoing chat with someone for weeks and weeks, and that first date will still be scary, like a cold call. You never know. You could be sitting down with a completely different person. To me, looking back, Johnny, the 80s and early 90s were grand. Sure, you had AIDS, but it was still a man-on-man disease. There was no social media, no cell phones, at least not like we have them today, no screens anyway. Prozac and Ritalin weren't handed out like candy. Drinking and driving wasn't necessarily a crime, but practically a way of life. And the single ladies went out drinking specifically to lose their inhibitions, while not being held accountable if someone were to shame them afterwards. And back then, if you wanted to meet people, you actually had to leave your house. Yep, I miss those times. They were fun. And no one was in your business with social media. No cell phone madness. You know what I mean. Speaking of the benefits of male success, something that was important to know for geeks like me, I finally had the realization of what women want in their men. Simple. Power, money, or both. And no matter how un-PC this may sound, some, perhaps the majority, are willing to sell access. Weinstein's the perfect example. But predictably, women who make trades for their bodies often have seller's remorse. Though I'm sure guys in the single scene sometimes feel that way too. And another thing, it's amazing what money and fame can do to improve a guy's looks. Think of Quentin Tarantino, Danny DeVito, or some of the comedians like Carrot Top. Come to think of it, most all comedians, if you analyze it. Who knows, maybe that's why they got into comedy. I bet for those guys, it's always lights out and fantasy time for her when he finally gets her in the bedroom. And Weinstein? Wow, those women that didn't put up a fight. They must have been pretty drunk or beyond desperate or clinically blind. Then you read about some of those ladies' testimonies, saying he was not only unattractive and gross, but sorely lacking in personal hygiene. Wow. As they used to say back in the 80s and 90s, gag me with a spoon. So in talking about the fairer sex, Johnny, I don't even know if you could say that anymore, can you? Don't get the wrong idea simply because I mentioned anal a couple of times in this email. The word has multiple meanings, you know, and thus makes for a much more interesting dialogue. In other words, I just tossed it in a couple times, hoping it would stand out in your pile of correspondence. Signed, Addison. All right, thanks for that, Addison. By the way, the A word, the anal word, got my attention all right. By the way, how do you go through life with a name like Addison without getting bullied? I suppose it's like having the name Thurston Howell III. Just imagine if they ever did a Gilligan's Island prequel. I kind of think that young Thurston Howell III would get his ass whooped with monotonous regularity. You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, we can schedule a one-on-one phone or Skype consult. Just send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. And if you want to get on the waiting list for my next week-long Expat Insider Seminar in Central America, where you're guaranteed to get a 2 to 5 year head start on your Plan B, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Nos vemos.